Richard Schwartz, President Emeritus of Jewish Veg, and the author most recently, I got the book right here, of Vegan Revolution, Saving Our World, Revitalizing Judaism. I'd like to welcome you all to this special, special event, really historic, trying to restore and transform the ancient new year for animals. Now we've got a wonderful panel here, and I'm going to introduce them all in a minute. So in a way, I want to apologize to all the speakers, number one, because the time limits, introductions will not be as much as you really deserve to have. And also I'm going to try to limit everybody to 3 minutes. I'm going to try to set a timer to 2 minutes and 45 seconds so that if you hear that, please finish up shortly after that. Okay, so to start off, Rabbi Gabriel Cousins, is he on already? Gabriel, he's meant to be first speaker. And Gabriel, are you here? If not, we'll have to go on to second speaker. I'm assuming over here. So, that's Rabbi Akiva Gersh. Akiva, are you here? We can't see everybody. Oops. Let me just, okay. Well, next is Rabbi Yonatan Gershom. Trying to see, you know, let's see if I click on this arrow, see who is also here. Okay, so we have Rabbi Yonatan Gershom. Okay, he's a storyteller and an author, written many books on Judaism. I've been happy to work with him and all. And most important, he's got the book on Kippuris, which is Kippuris Then and Now, toward a more compassionate tradition. So Yonatan, you'll be our first speaker. Unmuted. Yonatan?
Yeah, okay, yeah. Can you hear me now?
I hear you.
Okay, you want me to speak now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, maybe starting this off with a story is not a bad idea. I know that most of the people here have all the academic background stuff, but I'm going to start us off with a story. One of the things I want to focus on for this is that we need to make personal connections with animals. You know, we can talk a lot about all the statistics and everything else, but if people in our community don't have a personal connection with animals, then it just goes over their head. So this is the story I was going to open with, and I will use it. Back in the 1970s, late 1970s, early 80s, when I was in Minneapolis, Rabbi Moshe Adler was the Hillel rabbi, and his son, Amitai, wanted a dog. And Rabbi Adler was terrified of dogs, and a lot of Jews are, because we grow up with these stories about dogs tracking us down in the Holocaust. And when I worked as a nursing home chaplain, I was told stories of how when a pogrom started, the first thing you heard was the barking and howling of the dogs as the peasants let them loose on the village. So Rabbi Adler could not bring himself to get his son a dog, but they compromised and they got a cat. And the cat, you know, it was a kitten, it grew up, and they got to know its meows and its purrs and its body language. And later on, Rabbi Adler told me, he said that was the first animal that he had ever had or a relationship with, an actual one-to-one, knowing it as an individual. And he realized that cats have a language, that cats communicate, and that this was something he'd never thought about either. His son, Amitai, who is now an adult, of course, has no fear of dogs or other animals. Now, I share this story because it's very common in our community for people to really have no connection with animals. And so when we're talking about cruelty to animals in factory farms, et cetera, you know, if they've never met a chicken, they've never met a cow, they have, this is not personalized, it's sometimes really hard to connect. Back in 1997, I made the Breslov pilgrimage to the grave of Rebbe Nachman of Breslov in Uman, Ukraine. And I was amazed at how rural it was. And we've all grown up with stories about how Jews were locked up in ghettos and all of this. But here were people living in a village, which really was, you know, kind of turn of the 20th century. They were still using horses and wagons. They had cars, but gasoline was expensive. So, you know, they had ducks running around the house and not the house, but the yard. And they had, you know, goats in the backyard, things like this. One guy was walking his sheep down to the river to graze. This is how our ancestors grew up. They had daily contact with horses and cows and sheep and goats, plus wildlife and cats and dogs. And we have become so urbanized, at least in the United States, that there are children who do not believe that the stars are really there. They think, and I tell you this, okay, they think that when you say the stars will be numerous as, you know, Abraham's told them numerous as the stars, they think that this is, I got a timer, okay? All right. I guess that's it. So think about the personalization, okay? Connecting
person. Forgot to mention you have that hobby farm, so Jonathan is really the closest to animals and all, and good luck, keep up the good work. By the way, I wanted to mention that this is really a special event that it's in conjunction with the publication of my ebook, which is just the beginning, due to be published either today or tomorrow. I'm hoping to send that to thousands of rabbis and, you know, really trying to get this new year off the for animals off the ground, because I think it's needed more than ever. And I'll give reasons for that later on, alphabetically of my time. Okay, Rabbi David Seidenberg, alphabetically, is next. Is David Seidenberg here? I hope people will be coming on soon. Well, okay, if not, we have Rabbi David Wolpe, who's the rabbi of Temple Sinai in California, and he's written many books and many, many articles, and he's known as one of the leading conservative rabbis in the U.S. Okay, and oh.
Thank you. I'm grateful to you, Richard, and I'm grateful to Jonathan for beginning us with a story that is so specific and particular, and because I'm going to be broad in general, and I think the two of them together make a nice fit. What I want to urge people to think about is that when we talk about having a world of less suffering, if you think of pain as just its own entity, that is, not human pain, not animal pain, but just pain that exists in the world. And you make a commitment to reducing the amount of pain in the world. The truth is that for human pain, there is something we can do. For pain of those other creatures we share the world with, there is a great deal that we can do, more in some ways immediately than even human pain. And so without in any way equating morally human beings and other animals, and people will have very different takes on that. And obviously the Jewish tradition privileges the human soul in a special way. It nonetheless sees pain, needless pain, suffering as an evil. And the question is, what can we do to reduce that in the world, to expand our circle of compassion and close the circle of suffering? And I think one of the things that we can all do is to try to encourage a world in which things like factory farming are no longer necessary and no longer exist, and that needless suffering that we inflict on our fellow creatures simply because we can, as a function of appetite and not of ethics, is something that we can recommit to in this new year, since after all, it was on Rosh Hashanah, according to our tradition, that the Garden of Eden was created, the place where we didn't eat one another, we creatures in the world. We were all vegetarians, and maybe, God willing, one day we will be again. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. And next, we're going to call on Dr. Miriam Mizell. I'm taking her a little bit out of alphabetical order because she may have to leave early. And Dr. Miriam is a holistic doctor, maybe one of the few in Israel. There should be many, many more. Written many articles on health, given many talks on health. So look forward now to hearing from Dr. Miriam. I know she's going to share some PowerPoint with us. I hope.
Okay, let me share my screen. And yeah. And okay, so there are many, many, and thank you, Richard, for inviting me in that introduction. There are many, many good reasons to remove animal products from our diet, care for others, developing our own compassion, protecting the environment, and of course, health. And I am going to talk very briefly about the health aspect. This talk is an excerpt from a longer talk that I do on the subject. And it's based on a book chapter and also a lecture I do for the University of Winchester. Our diet is the number one cause of death and the number one cause of disability. And most deaths, this is US data, are preventable, meaning they are premature. And so I'm going to relate specifically to coronary artery disease, which is, depending where you are, the number one or number two cause of death. And the statistics in the United States are still very high. I believe in Israel right now, cancer is the number one cause. But premature death means loss of years, loss when we think about it in a personal way. We probably all have someone in or know someone who has died of a heart attack. And so those are lost years of human life. Just for people who don't know, the coronary arteries are the arteries of the heart which actually feed the muscle to the heart. And when these become blocked with cholesterol, then a heart attack can occur. One third of first heart attacks are fatal. So this is a very serious situation. So two researches that were done almost in parallel in the pre-internet time by doctors Esselstein and Ornish used, they called it a low-fat vegetarian diet. It was a vegan diet. And they were able to take patients who had advanced coronary artery disease, had had stents, had had heart attacks. Some of them, there was no further interventions that they could have. And they put them on this diet and without any animal products whatsoever. They universally had improvement in their angina symptoms, improved exercise tolerance, blood flow to the heart, reduction of plaque in the heart arteries. And here we can see improvement of blood flow to the heart within the first year. Here it's difficult to see, but we can see that arteries that were narrowed have become opened. So everybody is at risk for coronary artery disease, and probably everybody who is over 60 has plaque in their arteries, maybe over 50, maybe even younger. To know that this is reversible with diet is really a miracle, because these people got better. They were able to do things they couldn't do during their illness. They avoided having procedures which are risky, like stents and operations. And there is a vast body of literature from other researchers who have shown remarkable results also using plant-based diets, basically. And so, I think, yes, I'm okay. All right. So, you know, on the principle of first do no harm, we medical people and patients should be thinking about this, should be looking at this, and that if one reduces or removes animal products from the diet, there are, of course, benefits to the environment, benefits to the animals. And I believe it is better for us as humans to avoid taking the lives of animals. And thank you.
If this time at the end, we'll give people a chance if they want to add some points in the world, but to have like 13, 14 speakers. Some aren't here yet, so maybe there will be time. So we can give people a chance to add or ask questions to each other. Okay, next, going back toward the alphabet, Dan Brook is a professor of sociology, San Jose State, and author of Our Fate Kabbalah, Eating and Eating the Earth. He maintains some vegan websites, and I've had the pleasure of working with him. We have some co-authored articles. Matter of fact, we had a co-authored article on climate change cover story in the Jerusalem Report. So look forward to hearing from Dan.
Thanks, Rich. Good to be with all of you here. I was thinking that, you know, the animals need us to be as vegan as possible. Our health, human health, needs us to be as vegan as possible. The climate needs it. The rest of the environment needs it. The Amazon rainforest needs it. The air, the water needs it. We need it for resource conservation. But none of those things need the Jewish New Year for the animals that we want to resurrect and celebrate. They don't need the holiday. It is we who need the holiday to elevate our spirits and to raise awareness. It's the Jewish people collectively that need this holiday so that we can become better people, so that we can be better advocates for health, for animals, for climate, for forests, for air and water, for our natural world that's so precious that we need to protect. The only one we have. And I'll leave it there to make up for other people's time.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.
So keep up the good work. Dan has been doing so much for the vegan cause, and it's really great. Okay, next we have Jeffrey Spitz Cohen. He is the executive director of Jewish Veg. And under his leadership, a lot of good things have been happening. We've got a board of directors I'm proud to be on, and we have a wonderful staff. Mm-hmm. And then Sarah Eisel, one of the staff members, is here. And also the Bennett Council and the Advisory Council, and many, many positive things happening. Website being added to and really improved. So, mm-hmm. Jeff, look forward to hearing from you.
Thanks, Richard. Dan. Who is on our advisory council is a tough act to follow because he put it beautifully why we need this holiday. I would just add this. In the Ten Commandments, as we all know, those keep the Sabbath. And in Exodus, we get the instructions. And instructions include giving animals, specifically cattle, which represent the animals, giving the animals a day of rest too. So, needless to say, this is not happening today in agriculture. So the least we can do as Jews is give the animals a holiday, since we're denying them the rest on Shabbat that we're commanded to give them.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and forward to working with you, continuing, and all the great work that Jewish Veg is doing. And let's see, next we have Lionel Friedberg to speak. And he is a multi-award-winning, director, producer, cinematographer, screenwriter. I had a wonderful pleasure of being the associate producer along with him. A wonderful video. I hope you've all seen it. If not, look for it. It's called A Sacred Duty, Applying Jewish Values to Help Heal the World. And I went around with one for a couple of weeks in Israel, and then he continued on that. And the important thing is, never could have done it except that Lionel did it as a labor of love and dedication, didn't take one penny of professional fee. Also, his wife Diana is a professional editor. So we came out with this wonderful, wonderful video. And so look forward to hearing from you, Lionel. I think Lionel is here. Maybe he's muted. Lionel? Oops. Oh, okay. I think you're muted.
Have to unmute yourself.
You're muted. Unmute.
Unmute myself. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we hear you.
All right. Well, Richard, again, you know, I want to salute you for organizing this event. It's so timely. And as I've said to you so many times, you know, you are a real light unto all of us for leading the way. And so again, for setting this up today, it's a privilege to be with all of these people, particularly some of the rabbis with whom I worked on Sacred Duty with you, David Wolpe, Yonasan, and others. And Jeffrey, it's good to see you again. But anyway, I know time is limited. As a filmmaker, I've been very privileged to work many, many times with animals. I've made documentaries in many continents around the world, and it's been an absolutely extraordinary experience for me to get to know the animal kingdom the way I have. I've worked with National Geographic, the Learning Channel, and many, many others. Animals are extraordinary beings, and what I've learned to do is to respect them as my equal. We may be more intelligent, and we may have opposing thumbs, and we can make tools, and we can do all sorts of wonderful things, but they are incredible beings, and we share the planet with them, and they now need the respect that they deserve, instead of the exploitation that goes on, mainly for economic reasons and for greed. And we really have to do something about changing this. So the new year for the animals will be a way of heralding this new kind of thinking. You know, I grew up as a child during the darkest days of apartheid in South Africa. And so I know what racism is all about. And we've had all these movements around the world. We've overcome racism pretty much around the world. We have amazing pioneering work for human women's rights, LGBT rights. This is the last huge major frontier we need to address. And it's time to actually get there. And I'm hoping that, you know, with young people, I see young people around me all the time converting to vegan diets. By the way, we have over 100 dedicated vegan restaurants now in Los Angeles. And it's wonderful. And I know that Israel is a very, very vegan society, and there are wonderful restaurants all over the country. The world has to go that way. We have to show the way. You know, when it comes to tolerance and when it comes to dealing with other beings, it all comes down to one thing, to compassion, to chemla, to rachamim, to rachmanut. As Jews, we have to embrace that idea, which is what basically Rabbi Wolpe was saying earlier. But of course, there are profound health issues as well, as has been said. You know, I was diagnosed with a terminal illness 30 years ago, and I was given years before I'd be on dialysis. And because of my vegan diet, it's now been 30 years, and I've bypassed that. It's been an amazing thing for my health. We need to get that out. So let us introduce this. Let us bring on the new year for the animals. Let us show the way, and let us really be, as we should be as Jews, a light unto the nations by setting that example. Thank you very much.
Okay, amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. And Lionel has been super in giving me wonderful advice and suggestions over the years, and forward to that. Let's see. Next, we have David Kranz. And first, I want to thank David so much. He's the host for this. He's the founder and president of HSEAM. And HSEAM has some wonderful subgroups, including Green Zionist Alliance, Dukology. And Dukology is wonderful. I've been posting many, many articles there. It's wonderful. Jews of the Earth, Rabbis and Cantors for the Earth. So is doing some wonderful, wonderful things, finishing up his PhD on Shemitah right now. So look forward to hearing from you, David.
Thank you, Richard. One second here, as I get this loaded here, because this apparently went away. So sorry, one second.
Okay, I'm not gonna start your time until you get it set. Sorry to try to hold people to a short amount of time, but say we have a lot of speakers and hopefully this is just the beginning. You know, it's gonna be recorded, we'll get it out to many people. And as I've indicated, I'm hoping to really get this ebook out to many, many people. Okay.
Are you able to see my screen? Okay.
Yeah, I'm seeing it perfectly.
Okay, great. So thank you very much. I'm David Kratz. I'm the head of the Senior Ecological Judaism, a researcher at Arizona State University School of Sustainability. Real honor and pleasure to be with you all today. I have great gratitude to all the other speakers on this call. This is very inspiring work, and I'm honored to be presenting with all of you. So this year is a Shemitah year, and last year when we did all of this, I spoke about Shemitah, and I spoke about how in Shemitah, the land rests, and people rest, and non-human animals rest, and that leads to equality between land, humans, and non-human animals. I also spoke about how specifically like ways that non-human animals rest in Shemitah, that involves fences being removed, the rewilding, and indentured animals that are also rewilded, and a vegan diet for humans. So I covered all that, you know, last year. I also spoke about the history of diet in the Torah and how people started out as vegan and in Shemitah returned to veganism as a return to the idyllic Eden. Covered all that last year. This year, I want to talk about Jewish New Year's and Jewish cosmology. So there's five New Years in Judaism. The first you're probably most familiar with is what we call Rosh Hashanah, which is the New Year for years that follows on the first of Tishrei. We also have a new year for months that falls on the first of Nisan. So like in the Gregorian calendar, years and months, those years, they coincide with January 1st. And in Judaism, those are separated. Years on the first of Tishrei, months start over on the first of Nisan. We also have a new year for trees. That's on Tu B'Shvat, the 15th of Shvat. And a new year for kings, which would vary dependent upon which king, but it's the anniversary of the king's ascent to the throne. And then finally, we have a new year for non-human animals that falls on the first of Elul. So there's another way to think about this, right? We could think of the new year for years as an anniversary of planetary time, anniversary of creation, you know, of the earth. The new year for months as seasonal time. So the anniversary for the seasonal cycle, the anniversary for trees as both the anniversary for trees, but more broadly as it's celebrated today, the anniversary of nature, basically, for a new year for nature, anniversary for kings as a new year for people. And then naturally to then complete our Jewish cosmology here, the new year, the anniversary for non-human animals on the first of Elul. So another way to think about this is all of creation in balance, right? So we have Rosh Hashanah celebrating, you know, the near the birth of the universe, right? We have the first of Nisan for the Earth's seasonalities, right? And then, you know, Tu B'Shvat for trees and nature. And then the anniversary of kings, you know, for people, right? And what are we missing here? We're missing, of course, non-human animals, the first of Elul for Rosh Hashanah L'Abahema. So with that, we have a full balance of creation, and the Rosh Hashanah L'Abahema brings together our Jewish cosmology. So it's another way of thinking about how all of these New Years work within Judaism. And with that, I'd like to thank you all so very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. And again, really appreciate it. And David is also hosting Alon Tal, who's a leading environmentalist in Israel, an MK in the previous government, and some wonderful, wonderful programs. Okay, next we have Dr. Irene Lancaster, the Bible scholar, academic, educator, and translator. She's initiated courses on Jewish studies, Bible, and Hebrew in a number of UK universities. In 2008, she founded the Broughton Park Jewish Christian Dialogue Group. And for the past 5 years, she's written for the global website Christian Today. Oops, that was okay. And she also has been super, super in helping to edit this ebook. So really appreciate that. So look forward, Irene, to hearing from you.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
So I'm speaking to you from the UK, and I think I might be one of the only people from the UK here, if not the only one. I'd like to thank Richard, who I've not known for a very long time, for his huge humor, generosity of spirit, coming to speak to our dialogue group in the UK, which is now through COVID and Zoom international, including Israel and North America. And I would also like to say something about our partnership with Hazon Perlman, as a result of us getting onto American history in my dialogue group and finding a very open community that wants to hear from other people. I'd like to say that the person who founded Hazon came from just around the corner from where I live in Greater Manchester, and I taught in his school, and that was Nigel. So I'll finish that, because I know you've got a speaker from Hazon here. So I'm not an expert at all on this subject like other people, but I'm going to talk about other aspects that you haven't mentioned already. First of all, I've just reviewed the book by Rabbi Yedidya Sinclair of Yerushalayim on Rav Kook's Shemitah year, and I knew Rabbi Sinclair, who is brilliant, when I had another book launch at Cambridge University, and he was the Jewish chaplain, and this was in 2003. And it's nearly 20 years since, through this awful COVID and Zoom, that I got to meet him again through Hazon. And Rav Kook was really a pioneer in this, and he should be followed. And of course, he was the first chief rabbi of Israel when it was under the unfortunate British mandate. So that is going part of the way. I also, because Hazon asked me to give a talk on the subject of these things, it was the same time as COP26 in Glasgow, which, as you know, is in Scotland, part of the UK. And some of my ideas, just taken from basic Jewish teaching, was used by very important people, not me, at the United Nations on behalf of Judaism, and also to religious people of all denominations in Glasgow. The thing is that I've, apart from being an academic, I've taught Haider, and the kids always used to ask me, if we've got New Year for trees, what happened to the fourth one? You know, by fourth, they meant we've got Rosh Hashanah, as the previous speaker said, we've got Rosh Hashanah, we've got the Nisan. I thought Kings was the same, but never mind, he knows better than me. We've got this wonderful New Year for trees now that has come back and also became defunct. What about animals? And I didn't know what to say. I did not know what to say. I asked various rabbis why it was defunct, and they said, well, it was a long time ago, Talmud, but things have moved on. As somebody else has said, Israel is now the center of veganism and also vegetarianism. And even the press in Britain, the non-Jewish press, has said so. And Israel and the Jewish community in North America can really, you know, push for this. I think animals should be given their turn. It is true that a lot of Jewish people, till recently, were scared of animals, as the first speaker absolutely said. The UK, ironically, is very keen on plants, greenery, and animals. They haven't always been, and are not to this day, that keen on Jews. We have to push the agenda, because we do not wish it to be Jews versus animals, as is very often brought up in the UK and Europe. I mean, the Queen of Holland wrote to my friend here and said, "We very much regret, knowing what you went through in the Holocaust, that the Green Party in Holland wants to ban Brit Mila and stuff like that." We have to be very careful that this isn't just the general way things are going. We have, you know, have got this marvelous old religion, which is also young as well, and we need to push that aspect, in my opinion. So I think animals should be given their turn, and I think these are the main things that kids are now asking for it. And I think, you know, when I was young, we didn't keep Tubish fat. We knew nothing about it. In 40 years ago, as a family, we went to Yerushalayim, and my daughter was at school there. And suddenly we went out in a truck to plant trees in the Jerusalem forest and further afield. And this was Tubish fat. And it was when the first almonds were coming up in what to us in the UK is midwinter of February the 15th or something. And, you know, plants are very important, but so are animals, as so many of you have said, and also as others have said about health. So my main reason is Richard is the most amazing enthusiast. I think I've only known you for about a year. I can't tell people how generous, helpful, and, you know, he signs petitions for us in the UK. He really cares about other sentient beings. And I want to support you in your quest and in your desire to get this done as much as I can. Thank you.
Thank you very much. By the way, I've been giving people a little more time since some of these speakers didn't come. So if we have a time at the end, if any of the previous speakers want to add any points, we'll try to give you time for that. Okay, so I guess my turn, as I mentioned, I'm President Emeritus of Jewish Veg and author of that number of books, and most recently, Vegan Revolution, Saving the World, and Revitalizing Judaism. So the idea here is the ancient holiday initially for tithing for animals. We want to restore it, but of course transform it into a day devoted to increasing awareness of Jewish teachings on compassion for animals and how far the realities are from that. So why do we want to restore it? Well, so, you know, Jews ought to be Rachmanim b'nei Rachmanim, compassionate children of compassionate ancestors, emulating Hashem, God, whose compassion is over all of his creatures, as indicated in Ashrei, Psalms 145, number 9. And also because the amazing thing that animal-based diets not only violate Jewish teachings on compassion for animals, but tying it in with what Miriam said, with taking care of our health, protecting the environment, conserving natural resources, helping people, and pursuing peace. And to me, the most important reason, and we see it this summer, the heat waves, the world is burning, the wildfires, what's happening in Kentucky now with the flooding, people are seeing more and more climate change, and it's essential, everything possible has to be done. Most important thing is a shift to plant-based diets that will reduce the methane from cows, a very potent greenhouse gas, but more importantly, it would permit the reforestation of the 1/3 of the world's land, ice-free land area. Plant these trees, there used to be 6 trillion, now there's 3 trillion, that could sequester some of the atmospheric carbon dioxide. The experts think 350 parts per million is a threshold. We have just reached 420, 350, danger point, 420. So we have to bring that down. So they keep talking about zero emissions, very, very important, but even more important, we have to bring that down. And one of the most important things now, and Israel is a pioneer on this, is that there are so many plant-based substitutes for meat and other animal products with a texture, taste, and appearance so close to the outer that even long-time meat eaters can't tell the difference. That there's no real excuse for that. So we have to get this word out, and I'm hoping that this effort, you know, it'd be miraculous if we can do it, but the Kabbalists restored Tubish flat after the destruction of the temple. We have to do it. You've all given so many good reasons for that. So I'm hoping this is just the beginning. The book is, I mean, it's an e-book, but I hope it'll be improved year in, year out, and I'm hoping to send that to all of you and please spread it as widely as possible. Okay, so with all that, and many thanks to David again for hosting. Many thanks to all of you for speaking, and please help spread the word. And now, I'm going to say Acharon Haviv, unless some of the other people came who initially went on here, Yael Shemesh, professor of Bible at Boilon University. She's also head of the Fania Gottsfeld Heller Center for Study of Women in Judaism. She's been a long time vegetarian vegan activist in Israel and for animal rights and many things. Written, I know, a number of papers, very academic scholarly papers on the subject. So we look forward now to hearing from you.
Thank you, Richard, for everything. I definitely support the initiative to dedicate Rosh Chodesh Elul to soul searching regarding our relationship with our fellow creatures in this world. The way animals are treated today in the modern food industries is immoral, as well as inconsistent with the halachic requirements, according to which we must take into account the animal's physical and emotional needs. The paradox is that everyone knows how to bring evidence to the importance of the mitzvah to prevent animal cruelty, tzar ba'alei chayim, such as the prohibition to muzzle an ox while it threshes grain, the demand to help ease the burden of a donkey lying under its burden, and the like. But most of those who quote these verses do not translate this important principle into modern reality, where a hen cannot move around in her cage, nor spread out a wing. The genetic distortions employed to animals in order to increase profitability, causing them to suffer and collapse, and more. It is important that we ask ourselves, when was the last time we helped unload a donkey or avoid blocking an ox while it threshed grain? And when was the last time we seriously considered the question of how we, as individuals and as a society, can prevent animal suffering as required of us according to the halachic principle of Tzar Ba'alei Chaim? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And hatzlacha in continuing your wonderful work for a more vegan world. So I think we had to speak. So I want to raise a question to people here, and how do we get more involvement? For example, Dan, you're an academic. How do we get the professors? How do we get the students? How do we use the college campuses to get people more involved on this? You know, people on the college campuses, reasoning is so important. How can they be ignoring climate change is such a threat, and the animal-based diet is such a contribution to that? And Miriam, how can we get the doctors? So you pointed out it's so clear, and as you mentioned with Dr. Dean Ornish, Caldwell Edelstein, there have been so many medical studies and peer-reviewed medical journals, scientific journals. How can the medical profession keep ignoring that, as you said, heart disease can be reversed, diabetes can be reversed, etc.
I'll just say no easy answers, as you know, but we need to keep doing. We need to keep doing what we're doing. Some things take longer than we would hope, but it's only because of the people. I mean, if we look back historically, I mean, the people like us who got together, the activists, the people who had the ideas and pushed, the people who wrote things and spoke things and organized amongst their friends and colleagues and families and co-congregants. So, you know, we're doing it. It doesn't mean we can't do better, but we're doing it. And it's also important to remember that other people are doing it too. It's not that everyone is ignoring these issues. There are other Zoom meetings and classrooms and people petitioning and setting up events, and there's people marching in the streets, and there's people lobbying their leaders, their political leaders, their religious leaders, their corporate leaders, and so on. So we need to encourage them, and they need to encourage us, and we'll all do as much as we can. And whether it's in this generation or the next, we're part of that. And that's the most important thing, that we're doing something. We're doing it from our spiritual perspective.
When you say that in this generation or the next, there's so little time. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in 2018 said that we have only till 2030 to make unprecedented changes in order to make a difference. And what happened now, 4 years later, the atmospheric carbon dioxide reached an all-time high. So we're heading in the wrong direction. And this summer with the burning and all, we've got to get that message out that, as someone put it, the cow in the room is such an important factor. 6 trillion trees down to 3 trillion. And by the way, they're still burning them down, cutting them down in the tropical rainforest to create more pasture land, more grazing land for animals. So Miriam, I don't know if you want to add anything. How do we get the medical profession, Miriam, to speak out as you've been doing and to make a difference? Because I think there's no doubt that the whole food plant-based diet that you promote is so beneficial. And there's such an epidemic. It was just in today's, by the way, in today's Jerusalem Post, they did a study and they found a tremendous percent of Israelis that are overweight and obese, a tremendous amount that don't get any exercise at all. So how do we get the medical profession to really speak out and say that the vegan diet is by far, far, far the most healthful diet?
Well, oh, great question, Richard. I don't know if I can add very much, but I would say that there are changes that may not be that visible. For example, the food guidelines in many countries now at least include your plate kind of thing, or the food pyramid, without meat and animal products. That's a huge step, because we know that the farming lobbies are very influential and they always want to have meat in there. Medical journals are now universally talking about climate change as a major, major health issue for humanity, as well as pollution. And they don't always make the next step to saying, therefore, we need to cut out meat. But I think some people are connecting the dots. The American College of Lifestyle Medicine, which is a very respected body, advocates a whole food plant-based diet, which, by the way, the British Society of Lifestyle Medicine has kind of skirted the issue and said, no, keto's okay and everything's okay. I tell patients of mine, anyone who comes to me and they do well after not having been satisfied with their previous treatment and they haven't heard the kind of recommendations that I give, I say, please, please go back and tell your doctor, show them you got better. They thought you couldn't get better. You got better. And doctors are lifelong learners. So if you see something and then another patient comes and said, well, I got better from heart disease, I got better from diabetes, the Sloan Kettering, the big cancer hospital, just a couple of days ago had an article relating to a review, which I haven't yet seen, but, and I don't usually talk about cancer because I felt that we don't have the data to talk about it, but they have now said whole food plant-based diet is superior for prevention of cancer and for survival benefits after cancer has occurred. However, on the flip side, I was recently at a wonderful medical conference to do with restoring human values in medical education. And it was at a hotel and they served us lunch and I requested a vegan option. By the way, I was the only one. So when everybody else got a ham sandwich, I got the ham sandwich without the ham, two pieces of bread with a lettuce leaf and a slice of soap. And I've been vegetarian for nearly 50 years. So, you know, you think like there would be a little bit of progress, but sometimes you wonder. But I think we just have to keep doing what we're doing. And, you know, I don't like to argue with people. I'll help inform people when they're interested. I let people know I'm out there, but many doctors have very entrenched views that are not necessarily, in my opinion, based in the best evidence. But you have to know how to talk. You know, you can't come at scientists with dogma. You have to be able to show convincing evidence, point to convincing evidence from reliable authorities. And there's a journal now, the International Journal of Disease Reversal and Prevention, which is an open access journal. And all of our favorite medical people are involved, Ornish, Esselstein, Gregor, and all those people. And that is one it's hard to recommend things to doctors because I know people bring me stuff and I just say I can't read everything. I don't know. I really don't know. Yeah.
You bring something up here, a cover story I wrote for the Jerusalem Report. And on the cover, it says, should Jews be vegans? Richard H. Schwartz, some of you may know him, argues that eating animal products violates Jewish teachings. And he gave me four pages or so. And then the next issue, I wrote a letter asking people if they wanted to debate the issues, basically. So the important thing is we have a case that, you know, I'm about Yeshiva, returning to Judaism. There's certainly many rabbis that know much, much more. They may know the Talmud by heart, but they can't really respond to the fact that animal-based diets and agriculture violates so many fundamental Jewish teachings on taking care of our health, certainly treating animals with compassion. And now the environmental issue with climate change is so urgent. So that's why we need something very bold. That's why I'm hoping this restoring the new year of animals will make a difference.